Hey guys, what's up? Happy Thursday? Wednesday. Happy Wednesday. And I got an email message from someone who really, really likes my Cooking with Kengi videos, and she is a busy, busy, busy mom, and asked me if I would cook some meals for her. In exchange, she would pay me. So we worked out the price and everything. So today I'm going to be prepping her meals and getting them all ready. So Cooking with Kengi starts right now. Hey guys, what's up? I'm back. So the first dish I'm going to make is a mild Italian lasagna. And I've got my mild Italian sausage already ground up. I just did it in the food processor. In my case, the blender. And in my skillet here, I have a little bit of canola oil. So I'm just going to put all my sausage in here. And you can buy the sausage that's already in the case. And that's exactly what I did. I bought it already in the case, just decased it, and then ground it up in my blender. You can use your food processor or whatever you have. Like I said, I'm using a canola oil. You know, a lot of people use extra virgin olive oil and all that stuff. I'm not one of those people. It's either canola or vegetable oil, 100%. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to cook this, get it all nice and brown, just like I would a ground beef or a ground turkey. And then I'll show you the next step when I come back. Smells good. Alright, my shells and my meat is all done. I don't think that light's going to make much of a difference. Anyway, my meat is all done. And I am using the Barilla. And these are the rolled flat, like just like a homemade shell, but you don't have to boil these. That's the cool thing about these. I'm gonna put my meat onto the shell like so. I did drain a little bit of the oil off. Not all of it, but most of it I did. So that's the first step of the lasagna. I love these shells because you don't have to boil them. It's super, super easy. So the next step is the next layer. And I'm going to put a little bit of sauce on here, but let me show you how I made the sauce first. I'll be back in a second. Okay, my sauce is a combination of homemade and can. And the can that I use is the S&W Ready Cut Tomatoes. It's diced with green chilies and spices. I do add oregano. I add garlic. And I also take, for this small amount, I took 4 Roma tomatoes. It doesn't matter if they're firm or soft. I prefer them to be soft. And I just pureed them in my blender. And this is what I got. Again, it smells really, really scrumptious. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to put a little bit of this over the meat. Actually, I'm going to do the cheese first and then a little bit of this and then start the next layer. So I'll show you guys what it all looks like when I'm done. I am going to use, for the top, I am going to use an all natural fresh mozzarella. Get it at your better department stores. I got this one department stores. At your better markets, I got this one at Trader Joe's. Alright guys, so this is my ricotta cheese. And to my ricotta cheese, again, I added just a little bit of oregano, little bit of rosemary, just a pinch of salt, and I like Mediterranean sea salt that I use. And then I use the feathered Parmesan cheese. And I mix that up, and that's going to create the second layer. Be back in a second to show you what it looks like. Alright, so here's the second layer. And now I'm just going to add the shell. And I do cheat on the top. I don't break the shells on the top. And then sauce will go over that, and then the all-natural mozzarella, and then into the oven for everything to gel. And I'll be back in a second to show you the finished product. All right, so my lasagna's in the oven, and I have moved on to the next project, which is my meatloaf. I'm going to add some pepper. That's enough. I'm going to add some salt. Enough. You guys like that? I made that. I got two. One for my salt and then coarse black pepper. Also in the bowl, I have one egg slightly beaten. I have a small can of tomato sauce. And then again, I took two Roma tomatoes. These were soft. Chopped them up and kind of pureed them in a blender. And then that's in there. The breadcrumbs, and my salt, of course, salt and pepper, and the meat. So we're going to get this baby going. I'm going to mix this off camera so you guys won't see my hands get all messy. Be back in a second. All right, so the meatloaf is all ready to go into the oven. I don't know if I mentioned breadcrumbs or not in the last part, but I also use breadcrumbs, and I use a plain breadcrumb. You also notice that I'm not giving you guys exact measurements. I eyeball everything, and unless it's baking, you have to be exact. There's no eyeballing. So if you're going to ask me, well, how much of this did you use? How much of this did you use? Use your best judgment, or whip out a recipe and follow it. I remember somebody told me that they put milk in their meatloaf. I don't understand why somebody would put milk in meatloaf. But whatever. So here's the meatloaf. I formed it myself. It's in the pan. There's a couple of variations that I have to this. There are times when I want to get real creative. And on the inside, when you slice it, there is spinach. That's when I really want to get creative. And what I do is I take the meatloaf and I make it flat, just like this board. And I'll put the spinach inside, and then I'll roll it, form it, and then when you slice it into it, there's spinach on the inside. This family just wanted a traditional meatloaf, so that's what I did. I did add finely chopped red, green, and yellow bell pepper just to add some color to it. Another variation that I do on the meatloaf is a bacon wrapped meatloaf, and what I'll do is I'll do the bacon and then wrap, like strip, however many slices I want to get out of the meatloaf is however many slices of bacon that I'll use, and that's really good. I don't know if the restaurant is still in San Francisco or not, but Sauce in Hayes Valley, they have a really good meatloaf, so if they're still around up there in the San Francisco area, you guys should definitely check them out. Great place to get some good grub. So the meatloaf is ready. I know some people make the little indent. I don't do that. That's it. That's the meatloaf. I'm going to get this baby into the oven. And then we're going to move on to our final project, which is enchiladas. Back in a second. All right, I am back. This is my ground beef. Making ground beef enchiladas. as many as this will make. To this, I've already added salt and pepper, and that's it. I know a lot of people, I watch them make enchiladas and tacos, and they use things like taco seasoning packets. I don't do that. Salt, pepper, that's it. Sometimes I'll add a little bit of whatever enchilada sauce I'm using. I really love the Rosarita, but the store I went to doesn't carry the Rosarita brand. So what did I get? I got the Las Palmas. I used to use Gallego Brothers tortillas. I actually grew up next to the owners of that company in Santa Monica, but I don't know if they're still in business. So the tortillas that I use now are Guerrero. Or if I can get over to like a Diana's, I'll use Diana's tortillas because they're made fresh. So I don't need to show you guys how to make the ground beef. Of course, cook it till it's done. Ground beef does better if you just leave it alone, let it get hot, and then break it up so it's not big and chunky. But over in my next skillet over here, get you guys over to that, right there, is my oil that I have warming for the tortillas. And I'm just going to dip the tortillas in it really quick so they're easy to roll and they won't break. And then I will set them on this. So I will be back in a second. Let my oil get hot and show you guys how to dip them in and out really quick. And then we'll start to assemble the enchiladas. Back in. Okay guys, here we go. Tortilla shell. I do it with my hand. I don't suggest you guys do this if you're timid or if you're used tongs. But this is what I do. Tortilla shell, dip, dip, drain, and it's done. That simple. You don't want to fry it hard. It's done. That simple. So I'm going to finish getting these ready. As you guys can hear, my meat is sizzling pretty good. The lady who requested these enchiladas did ask for my twist, so I'll tell you what I did add to the meat. I used a beef-flavored chorizo. And I got that at John's, which is primarily a Mexican market here, with a full butcher counter and everything. Actually, I love John's supermarket. Be back in a second. Okay, so this is my enchilada sauce right here, and I'm warming it up. And the reason why I warm it up is because I dip the shells and then I roll, and I don't want to dip the hot shells into a cold enchilada sauce. Now, I know you're asking, well, what's that right there? What's that right there? Well, Gert, let me tell you. If y'all is up on Noah's Ark, you know what Gert means. Gert! Anyway, that was Mexican cocoa. And you only need a little bit. And all it does is accent and bring out the flavors of the enchilada sauce. Alright? So just a little bit. A little dab of do ya. And this doesn't need to be piping hot. It just doesn't need to be cold. That's warm enough. Off it goes. And we are about to get this party started. Girl.